This episode of It's the End of the World as We Know It and I Feel Fine was made possible by contributions from slaves like you. Spanky very much.
You have no idea what it would really take to change the world.
You're wrong.
Then tell me.
A series of devastating events. Events that would destroy the world's richest companies, that would crush the world's economy. A dozen 9/11s all over the world.
Like what?
Like targeted direct action against Halliburton. Against Dow Chemical, against McDonald's. Not just American companies. Against Airbus, against British Petroleum. Against any company that promotes global capitalism and destroys lives and cultures in order to increase its profits.
It's the end of the world as we know it. I feel fine.
Good morning, slaves, and welcome to another edition of It's the End of the World as We Know It and I Feel Fine, where we have no love for the motherfucking corporate media.
Tiger style.
Hey, get your fucking camera out of here. That's none of your fucking business, you cockbite. Unless you want trespassing, get the fuck out of here now.
I am your host, The Stimulator, and that angry man is Ronald Patrick Stavis, a longshoreman who was arrested for allegedly breaking in and sabotaging a grain terminal owned by EGT, an international commodities dealer, i.e. mega food gangsters. You see, the wheat pimps at EGT wanted to hire independent contractors at their grain crib, you know, to save a few bucks, but they soon found out that they fucked with the wrong union. Longshoremen have a long history of fucking shit up, and are the one union that has the power to shut down international commerce in the west coast of North America if the workers decide to take a fucking day off, just like they did in Seattle, Tacoma, and Everett. When the longshoremen saw their president arrested by the motherfucking popo in what some call a wildcat strike. And as it happens every September 11th, we will never forget the US-led coup of Salvador Allende, planned by that hateful shit swimmer and mass murderer Henry Kissinger. Thieves in Santiago marked the grim anniversary by doing battle with the fascist remnants of that mega torturer Augusto Pinochet. The street skirmish is just one in many on the ongoing insurrection that has been taking place in the skinny nation down south. The rebellion has been led by students who are demanding guaranteed free and quality education for all. But not all protests have ended in a riotous orgy. One early September action featured thousands of students exercising the strongest muscle in their body for 40 fucking minutes. Since I couldn't be on hand to teach those kids how stimulating I can be, I offer them my rendition of a classic makeout song. Bésame, bésame mucho, como si fuera esta la última vez.
Yo, fuck this shit. Bring on the motherfucking ultras.
Chill the fuck out, agitator. I was about to get to that. If sucking face is not your thing, maybe you can give soccer hooliganism a try. Apparently, the revolts that rocked Egypt earlier this year had a lot of help from a massive gang of soccer fans called the Ultras, who for years were the only force that routinely clashed with Mubarak's pigs. Here are thousands of Ultras talking some serious shit at riot cops during a soccer game. Check this shit out. Now, if only we could channel Canuck fans into a popular uprising.
I say things that other rappers won't say, cause my mind never closed like Guantanamo Bay. Hope you didn't build a statue or tattoo your arm, cause the drones are still flying over Pashtunistan. Did he defend the
war. No. He extended more, even had the time to attempt to coup in Ecuador. Morales and Chavez, the states are on a hunt for ya. Military now stationed on bases in Colombia. Take a trip to the past and tell him I was right. Ask Ali Abu Nima and Jeremiah Wright. Drones over Pakistan, Yemen and Libya. Is Obama the bomber getting ready for Syria? First black president, the masses were hungry, but the same president just bombed an African country like...
Peeps who take part in acts of sabotage to stop the corporate death machine deserve our motherfucking respect and support. Around the turn of the century, there was a flurry of activity in the US by a group calling itself the motherfucking ELF. But the Earth Liberation Front couldn't have successfully gotten the word out as to why they were fucking shit up if it wasn't for above ground peeps who could contextualize shit for the dumb fucks from the capitalist media. One of these brave motherfuckers is Leslie James Pickering, one of the founders of the ELF press office. Hey, LJP, how the fuck are you?
I'm doing pretty good.
So, Leslie James Pickering, the basics. What the fuck is the ELF?
The ELF stands for the Earth Liberation Front. It's an international underground organization with an autonomous structure. So, you basically can go out and take whatever action you feel is necessary to protect the environment as long as it fits the certain guidelines of the ELF and claim it as an ELF cell, and that's all it is. It's not like a type of membership where you can have a membership card and pay annual dues. It's an underground guerrilla movement.
Are you a member of the ELF?
No.
So, you mean to tell me that you don't do any gangster shit?
No, I was a spokesperson for the Earth Liberation Front press office when it existed, and so I spoke publicly very frequently about what the Earth Liberation Front was doing and why they were doing it, and so naturally people were focusing their energies towards me in terms of the FBI and the government who wanted to stop the Earth Liberation Front. So it's not like I could by day go and talk to Good Morning America and then by night go out and burn down buildings. It just didn't work that way. So my role was to speak publicly in support of the organization.
So why the fuck did you start something that could bring so much heat to yourself? Are you a fucking masochist?
If you're acting underground and you're taking guerrilla actions underground, part of what you want to do is expose the public, the general public, to what you're fighting for. Naturally, if you're going out and doing something illegal, you can't go up and talk to the world the next day and say, hey, I did this illegal thing and this is why I did it, without going to prison. So what we did, and we had copied a number of models, innovated a number of models that we had seen in the past, was form an organization that was just specifically made to help explain the motives and the ideology of the Earth Liberation Front to the public. And so it was kind of twofold. On one hand, we were doing news media interviews with whatever media we could get interested in the topic. And on the other hand, we were creating our own media, newspapers, booklets, zines, videos, whatever we could do to help get the message out of what the Earth Liberation Front was fighting for and why.
You were in 60 Minutes. Big fucking deal. But how did your life change after you became the poster boy for the FBI's public enemy number one?
The more attention we got from the media, the more attention we got from the government and just various branches of the Justice Department. So there was a lot of oppression, repression all along. Everything from, we had our offices and homes and vehicles raided by the FBI and the ATF on two separate occasions. And we had dozens of occasions where we had sort of quote chance meetings with the FBI, where they were either like just behind us in the grocery store line or ran into us at a public event or were knocking on our door with asking us questions about what, you know, who was in the Earth Liberation Front, what were they going to do next, were we members. So there was constant really negative interactions with the government repression apparatus.
Are people who do actions in the name of the ELF terrorists?
I don't really care what they call a freedom struggle. They're always going to call you a terrorist until you win. It doesn't matter if you are crashing planes into buildings or if you're just holding leaflets. If you're the forefront of the opposition, the most radical element of the opposition, you're always going to be a terrorist. And really, it's, you know, where we fall short as a struggle is letting that terminology and those sticks and stones, so to speak, like win. You know, call us a terrorist, do what you want to do. You know, we're going to fight for freedom and we're not going to stop until we win. And, you know, when Patrick Henry and George Washington and all those folks, you know, won their struggle, they weren't terrorists anymore. They were heroes. But up until then, you know, they had all kinds of words for them that weren't very nice, I'm sure. So,
Leslie, can you give me a lowdown on the most spectacular ELF actions?
It's not one action in particular. It's the notion that there's a group of people out there, there's an organization out there, there's a movement out there that is going to fight very literally. If you're not going to stop, you know, from all our letter writing and all our picketing and all our writing of our congressmen and everything that they tell you that we can do peacefully, well, then we're going to stop you anyway. This isn't just a lifestyle issue. This isn't just a, you know, a thing that is nice, you know, if to keep the environment around. This is an issue of life or death. And when you realize what's really going on in the world and what these corporations and what these government agencies are all like totally working hand in hand to do, it's complete annihilation of everything that keeps us alive in order to further their own personal, private, short-term economic gains. And so, you know, it's not a game that they're playing. They've got massive power and massive wealth all accumulated, and they're just stopping at basically nothing to reap all the benefits of the natural world. And so when you're up against that, it just does not make sense to ask politely, especially after you've been asking politely for generations and decades, and when they don't respond, then it's time to fight.
Thanks, Leslie. And that about does it for this edition of It's the End of the World as We Know It and I Feel Fine. Super duper fucking mega gratitude to the slaves who sacrificed their weekend taco fund to help this Heat Score show on the air. Micah, Stephanie, Richard, Christian, Linda, Susan, Michelle, Daniel, and Kate. Tamalitos. I just want to let you motherfuckers know that I'm heading to Japan in a couple of weeks to continue the NCIF World motherfucking tour. So if you have story ideas or cheap sushi restaurant suggestions, just visit my fucking website, stimulator.tv. I also want to let you motherfuckers know that Submedia has a new video project called Stop the Flows. So check that new shit out at stoptheflows.com. And please, stop fucking snitching.
Remember, kids, you can podcast high-quality video of this show at submedia.tv.